So hello everybody, and thank you Olivia and Ivan for giving an introduction to the conference. As has been just mentioned, by now I have moved out from IHES. I am a member of the Huawei Research Center in Paris. And so I have proposed to give a small course on geometry according to Grothendieck. And what I will explain is in fact taken from Récolte et Semaille, which in fact will be published in book form in the next month or maybe a couple of months. What I want to explain is that there is a mathematical content of Récolte et Semaille, which cannot be found in other texts by Grothendieck or his students and collaborators. And this content remains extremely interesting. So I begin by recalling that in 1970 happened one of the biggest losses in the history of mathematics when Grothendieck resigned from IHES and departed from the mathematical academic world in Paris. So 3 years later, he became a professor in Montpellier, far away from his previous scientific environment, after unsuccessfully applying for positions at Collège de France, at CNRS, and at Paris 11 University in Orsay. So he remained there for 12 years. In 1984, he stopped teaching, and he eventually got a CNRS position, where he remained for 4 years. And then, in 1988, at the age of 60, he officially retired, and he lived in isolation for the next 25 years, so a quarter of a century, up to his death in 2014. We have only partial knowledge of Grothendieck mathematics after the 1970s. So we know that there are several main themes which he studied during this almost this 40 years. So first, there is the theme of topological algebra with the text Pursuing Steps, which began as a letter to Quillen, with the text Les Dérivateurs, so this is 2,000 pages, with a very famous text of only 60 pages, Esquisse d'un programme, Sketch of a Program. And of course, there are very important letters to people as Thomasson, Bean. Okay, so this is one of the themes. Another very important theme is the theme of so-called Anabelian geometry. So I think this expression was proposed by him. Anabelian geometry is Grothendieck-Teichmuller tower and what he calls descent d'enfant, children's drawings. And in fact, in our conference, there will be lectures on that subject. So here, there are several texts on this subject. There is Esquisse d'un programme, Sketch of a Program. There is a very famous letter to Faltings, and there is a much longer text, La Longue Marche à travers la théorie de Galois, The Long March through Galois Theory. Then there is a theme of so-called tame topology, so in French, topology modérée, which Grothendieck wanted to introduce. So there are only a few pages about that in his text, Esquisse d'un programme, Sketch of a Programme. And by now, of course, in mathematics, we know there is the theory of so-called O-minimal structures, which many people think is an answer to what Grothendieck wanted. but we will never know for sure whether Grothendieck would be happy with the development of this theory. Is it really what he wanted or not? We will never know. A last theme which he mentioned is the theme of the scheme theoretic point of view on regular polyhedra and regular configurations. So on this theme, we only have just a few paragraphs in Esquisse d'un programme. And in Récolte Sommeille, he mentions that this theme is the most modest of his 12 so-called master themes, maître thème. But he adds as a remark that even a lifetime's work would not be enough to exhaust this theme. And then, of course, we know that when Grothendieck died, he left in his house approximately 70,000 pages, which so far nobody has read. So we don't know, or only very limited information on what is in his page. We know that on these 70,000 pages, there are several thousand pages devoted to mathematics. Okay. So by now, of course, we know that Grothendieck's golden years were at IHES, so in the 50s and 60s, and we all know that his main work was in algebraic geometry. But we may ask the question, do we know really well Grothendieck's algebraic geometry? So of course, on Grothendieck's algebraic geometry, we have thousands of pages to read. So here I have just written down in the slides the main text we can read. First, there is his programmatic 1958 talk at ICM, the cohomology theory of abstract algebraic varieties. And I mentioned that in Récolte Sommeille, Grothendieck says that this text, in fact, is thinks the best introductory text to his new algebraic geometry. There are also the text of many seminar talks which Grothendieck gave. So at the Bourbaki seminar, so this was gathered in the so-called FGA volumes, FGA volume, fondement de la géométrie algébrique. Then there are the talks at the Cartan seminar, in particular on construction techniques in analytic geometry. And in fact, in these talks, the theme of the Teichmuller tower is already studied by Grothendieck. We have just mentioned it will come back much later as part of the Anabelian geometry program. And there are also talks at the Chevalet seminar, so for instance, on intersection theory. Of course, we also have very important papers. So the first paper which begins Grothendieck arrival in algebraic geometry is of course the Tohoku paper sur quelques points d'algèbre homologique, which is very important for many reasons. There are several papers devoted to theorem cohomology. And there is one paper on the standard conjectures, and in fact, it is only published text where motifs are mentioned. Of course, there are also many letters, so there is a published correspondence with Serre, so this is a whole book. And there are many letters, of course, to other mathematicians, for instance, a famous letter to Tate about crystals. But in fact, we don't know how many unpublished letters there are. So according to the Montpellier website, out of the 28,000 pages of the Grothendieck Montpellier archives, 10,000 pages could not be made public because they require other people's permission. So this means it's these 10,000 pages, in fact, are letters. Probably most of these letters don't really talk about mathematics, are organizational, or they can be on many subjects. But for sure, on these 10,000 pages of letters, there are an important proportion, which is about mathematics, and which so far is not, has not been made public. And of course, there are the EGA volumes, so the four chapters, the first chapters of EGA. So I just want to recall that in the introduction to the first volume, Grothendieck mentions that he was forecasting 13 chapters. So this means we only have four chapters out of 13. And in fact, the SGS seminar was meant as a preparation for the future writing of more advanced EGA chapters, which in fact were never written. We only have some kind of preliminary notes for chapter 5 on the theme of hyperplane sections and conic projections. And last but not least, there are the SGA volumes, so the 7 published seminars, which in the total number of pages is 60 or is 6 or 7,000 pages. Okay, but by now, just reading Recoltes-Samay, we find some comments of Grothendieck about that. So at some point, he writes that already in the 1960s, he was seeing, so in French, un fier paquet de livres qui réclamait à corps et à cri d'être écrit. So this means a whole collection of books that were crying out to be written. And so he adds that he would have been willing to write all of them himself, but he couldn't do everything at the same time. And this is why these books were not written in the 1960s. And as he writes Recoltes-Samay, which means 20 years later, he states that in fact, none of these books he was seeing had been written to his knowledge, except for the PhD thesis written under his guidance. Okay, so this is a comment he made. Then, reading Recoltes-Samay, we learn that even excluding the SGA talks, he gave multiple series of talks at the HNS, and presumably, he always had written notes for these talks, because, in fact, Grothendieck always wrote everything. His way of doing research, his way of thinking was always by writing. So, for instance, there was a whole series of talks on the theme of Durham cohomology on crystals. And these talks were written down and by people who had followed the talks. For instance, it was published as the very important paper, Crystals on the Durham cohomology of skips. But some other series of talks were never published. So for instance, he mentions that in 1966 or 67, he gave a whole series of talks on motifs. And these talks were never written down, never published. So in the Montpellier archives, there are some notes about motifs. But in fact, I don't know whether these notes correspond to this series of talks or not. Okay, so then there are the SGA talks. So we learn, just reading Recoltes-Samay, that most SGA talks were given by him. And in fact, quite often, when you look at a chapter in a SGA volume, it corresponds to several talks by Grothendieck, not only one, but several. And so usually he gave his written notes to volunteers who were responsible for completing them, filling out all the necessary details. Some, at least some, possibly many of these completed texts have been published in the SGS series without his name appearing as author. So we learned that just reading Recoltes-Samay. But they have been written down, they have been published, so at least we can read them. But we also learn that the notes of several talks Grothendieck gave in the SGS seminar have never been completed and never published. So for instance, he gave an introductory talk for the SGF5 seminar. And this introductory talk was, according to him, an overview of duality in geometry, which means in multiple types of geometric context, differential geometry, analytic geometry, algebraic geometry with continuous or discrete coefficients, and so on. So this is what he calls the six operation formalism. So we understand by what he says in Récolte et Semaille that in his introductory talk, he explains the general formalism of the six so-called six operations, and he drew a list of many contexts where this formalism applies. But this introductory talk was never written down, and it is not published in the SGA volumes. In fact, in the SGA volumes, the expression six operations formalism does not appear at all. And in fact, we would not know that expression if Grothendieck had not talked about it, had not written about it in Récolte et Semaille. And there was also the concluding talk of SGA5, which was devoted, according to what he writes in Récolte et Semaille, to an overview of open questions. And so this means there was a list of open questions, which for him were very important. And this concluding talk also has completely disappeared. So, of course, Grothendieck mentioned he is extremely unhappy with the SGF5 volume as it was published. He calls that Edition Massacre, Massacre Edition. And it is especially pitiful for him. It is especially disturbing as, for him, the SGF4 and the SGF5 seminars, which for him were only one, were completely unified. This is the master part of his work in geometry. So why is he so unhappy with Edition? So he's unhappy because what is missing in the published volumes is vision and perspective, which in fact he had outlined at length in his talks given at IHS. So I already stated this important fact that the expression six operation formalism is not in the SGA volumes, and we would not know it without Récolte et Semaille. Okay, so here I make a parenthesis. This is just wishful dreaming. Is it possible to find in IHS archives a list of all talks with hopefully titles and even abstracts that Grothendieck gave there? And is it possible to find his written notes for at least part of these talks? And even for the talks which were eventually completed and published in the SGA volumes, maybe it would be interesting to have the original Grothendieck notes. Okay, so this is some wishful dreaming. Okay, so by now I'm going to come to what Grothendieck explains the mathematical content of Récolte et Semaille. So what he does in Récolte et Semaille is to present what is most important for him: the main simple unifying lines of his vision, the basic key notions, the basic key facts, and sometimes the more elaborate key facts. This is in fact very important because in fact Grothendieck elaborated a vision, and his vision is organized along very simple lines, and so these lines are not at all easy to understand when you read the EGA and SGA volumes. The EGA and the SGA volumes are very technical, and it is difficult to grasp the simple organizing lines of Grothendieck's thought. Okay, so what I'm trying to explain in these lectures are some of these simple lines of Grothendieck vision. So it begins with his view on mathematics in general. So what he says is that there are three types of thinking in mathematics, or three types of objects to be studied. So first, le nombre, number, and this is the arithmetic aspect of mathematics. Then there is what he calls la grandeur. So it is difficult to translate in English, maybe quantity or magnitude. And this is the metric or analytical aspect of mathematics. And lastly, there is the form, which is the geometric aspect of mathematics. And in fact, the word aspect is important here, because for Grothendieck, these domains are not separated. There are, in some sense, three ways to see mathematics. And of course, in these three, there is one way which for him is more familiar. It is not the number. It is not le nombre. It is not la grandeur, quantity, but it is form. So form is the aspect of mathematics which for him is more natural to study. And he says that form has thousands of different faces, but there is one face of form which for him is especially fascinating, and this is structure. So structure for him is one of the many faces of form, and so structure is part of geometry. Okay. And here he makes precise how to study structures. And the most important fact is that structures cannot be invented. They are already there. They are waiting for us to discover them, to express them, to grasp and understand them. In French, appréhender. Appréhender has this double meaning of grasping and understanding. And in order to uncover and express structures, we have to invent and refine languages. We have to build theories that are meant to account for what has been seen and understood. And he also adds that the quality of our inventiveness and imagination is the quality of the attention we pay, of our listening. In fact, he writes as if structures were speaking, and we have to listen to them with care, with attention. The word attention is very important for him, just as the verb to listen. Okay, and then just preparing these lectures, I was surprised to see that, in fact, Grothendieck gives some kind of definition of geometry, or more precisely, of his new geometry, of geometry as he sees it. So he says that arithmetic is a science of discrete structures. Analysis is a science of continuous structures. And geometry straddles these two types of structures. In French, la géométrie est à cheval entre le discret et le continu. And a little later, he writes that his new geometry is a synthesis between the arithmetic world of spaces without continuity principle and the world of continuous quantity, le monde de la grandeur continue. In his new vision, these two once separated worlds become one. Then, so this is how he sees geometry, or at least his new geometry, a synthesis between the discrete and the continuous. And then he says a little more about the characteristic features of geometry as he discovered them. So, for instance, he says that in 1955, when he began, when he moved from analysis to geometry, he writes the following: I still remember the striking impression, as if I were leaving arid steppes, to find myself suddenly in a sort of promised land with luxuriant riches, multiplying infinitely whenever the hand can reach to pick or to dig. So this means that, as opposed to analysis, geometry is a land of infinite luxuriant riches. He has this feeling, moving from analysis to geometry, that geometry is more rich than analysis. But how does geometry differ? How is it different than arithmetic? So here he doesn't write it explicitly, but it seems to me that the difference between geometry and arithmetic is not in the level of riches. It is in the fact that geometry is a land where luxuriant riches readily multiply infinitely under our hand. So this means that in geometry, we see these riches. They are not difficult to see. In some sense, we just have to open our eyes. Whereas in arithmetic, in the science of discrete structures, riches are also there, but they are much more difficult to see. Okay, so then I will move to this theme of the relationship between the continuous and the discrete, as Grothendieck writes about it in Récoltes Mai. When you just look for the word continuous or the verb continue in Récoltes Mai, you discover that they appear hundreds and hundreds of times, so maybe 500 or 600 times in Récoltes Mai, but with two different meanings. First, the mathematical meaning of continuous structures, and we are immediately going to go back to this mathematical meaning. But then, Grothendieck also uses the word in the meaning of ordinary language, applied to the research work. And I think it is interesting to see that there are these two meanings, because for Grothendieck, mathematics is not separated from life. And so in mathematics, there is the word of the continuous, but this word of the continuous has something to do with our experience of continuity. And so he writes about continuity in the research work. And what he says is that continuity is what we can give and what we have to give in our work. Whereas discontinuity, taking the form of unexpected discoveries, is what can be given to us. So once again, you see in our research work, continuity is what we can give, because this is really what is natural for us, just to continue what has already been done. Whereas unexpected discoveries are just given to us as a reward for the continuity in our work. So what does it mean, continuity in our work? First, continuity of effort, never stop too early, in fact, never stop. Never stop looking for a deeper understanding, especially if a feeling of unease, un sentiment de malaise, is still there, when you are not completely satisfied with your understanding of a situation. Another principle of continuity is always choose to express and develop first what is immediately in front of our eyes. So the principle of Grothendieck research is not to jump to difficult problems, but always do first what is just there, what looks easy. And a third aspect of that is that it is very important. In fact, it is mandatory. We have to continue almost as analytic continuation what has already been developed. And here there is a counter example, which immediately states. In fact, he would have expected the SGS series to continue after him. So this is why he writes the SGS-7 operation is not a continuation, but I feel it as a kind of brittle saw cut, or even pain saw cut, bringing the SGS series to an end. He would have expected SGA-8, 9, 10, and so on, on many other themes to be studied. Okay. But then, when he talks about discontinuity in discoveries, he gives an example. So the first example is the discovery that the formalism of the six operations and what he called biduality, I will explain a little later what it is, applies both to continuous coefficients and to discrete coefficients. So he writes this ubiquity of this formalism, both for continuous and discrete coefficients, appeared at spring 1963 as a surprise almost impossible to believe. In French, une surprise à peine croyable. The second example he gives is the discovery that the cohomology of the crystalline site with coefficient in the strength shift identifies with Durham cohomology. So here, this means that a very subtle complex of coefficients, so the Durham complex, the complex of differentials, has the same cohomology as the cohomology of the structure shift on a site he has introduced, which is quite simple, which is a crystalline site. So this means that the coefficients in some sense have disappeared in the definition of the site. And this, he says, this relation that I discovered in 1966 stunned me at the time. In French, elle m'a sidéré. So this, in French, it is a very, very strong expression. He was completely baffled by this discovery. So here you have an element of discontinuity, but this is given to him. Okay, and then I am going to move to the mathematical content in a more specialized terms. And I begin that with a quote of him about his new geometry as a word which unifies the continuous and the discrete. We can consider that the new geometry is, above all, a synthesis between these two words, which until then had been adjoining and closely interdependent, but yet separate. The arithmetic world, in which spaces without a principle of continuity live, and the world of continuous quantity, in the new vision, these two formerly separate worlds become one. So how is such a unification realized? In fact, he explains in Récolte Sommeil that there are different types of synthesis between the discrete and the continuous. So first, there is a building of a common house, in French, demeure, the building of a common house for the continuous and the discrete. And this common house is topos theory. It is an invention by Grothendieck of the notion of topos. So why is it a common house? So this is based on a double discovery. First, the fact that when you consider the categories of sheaves on topological spaces on the one hand, and on the other hand, the categories of pre-sheaves on a small category, so for instance of a group, so this means just the category of actions of a group, or more generally of actions of a monoid. So these two types of categories, one coming from continuous structures, the other coming from discrete structures. So these categories share the same general properties. So the second discovery is that when you associate to a topological space the associated category of sheaves on that space, And when you associate to a continuous map between two topological spaces, the associated topos morphism, which is a pair of adjoint functors, the pullback functor and the pushforward functors and shields, then this construction realizes an embedding of the world of continuity, so technically the category of topological spaces, into the world of discrete structures, here the world of categories. So this means that this very simple construction has embedded the world of continuous structures into the world of discrete structures. And in fact, Grothendieck writes several pages about this fact, which for him is extremely striking, unexpected, marvelous, and extremely important, just to be able to embed the world of continuity into the world of the discrete. The second type of synthesis which Grothendieck presents is what he calls ubiquity. This is the discovery that some phenomena are ubiquitous, both with continuous coefficients and with discrete coefficients. So the first most important example he gives is duality. So duality, as formulated by him, consists in a network of linear functorial constructions and their properties, which jointly generalize both Poincaré duality for singular homology and Serre duality for coherent modules. And this formalism appears ubiquitous in the most diverse topological or geometric context. So, by I just state that it consists in a system, first of the six operation formalism. So here I have written the six operations, but I will come back on that with more precision a little later. Then there is a notion of so-called constructible objects. And lastly, there is the phenomenon of what he calls biduality. And I will come back on all of this a little later. So this is the first and most important example of what he calls ubiquity, when the same phenomenon is observed both with discrete coefficients and with continuous coefficients. The second example he mentions is the Grothendieck-Riemann-Rohr theorem. So, of course, this is his version of Riemann-Rohr for continuous coefficients with the invention of categories, so everybody knows that. But he also mentions that in the FGS seminar, he had at least one talk, maybe possibly even several talks, on a Riemann-Rohr theorem for discrete coefficients, which means for Alladic sheets. And here, this talk was never published. In fact, I don't think that the statement Grothendieck mentions there, so this means a full Riemann-Rohr theorem for discrete coefficients, I don't think it exists even now. Nobody has, so Grothendieck has done that. He explains that in the FGS seminar, and it was never published by anybody. And it is still waiting. So it should be a generalization in arbitrary dimension and for arbitrary morphism of the so-called Grothendieck-Hogg-Schafarewitch formula. But the Grothendieck-Hogg-Schafarewitch formula is for curves, okay? And Grothendieck had done that in the 60s, but it was never published. Okay. The third type of synthesis is the construction of bridges between the discrete and the continuous. So here I use the word bridge. So in fact, this word has been chosen by Olivia Caramello for her theory of topos-theoretic bridges, so to build bridges using Grothendieck toposes. Because of that, it was interesting to see, for me to see whether Grothendieck uses the word bridge in French pont in Récolte et Semaille. And in fact, it is the word a few times, but this is always about the work of Mepcut and also Kashiwara, what Grothendieck calls the theorem du bon Dieu, which means Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, which, according to him, realizes a bridge between topology, algebra, and analysis. So this means a bridge is here a relationship or an equivalence between the theory with discrete coefficients and the theory with continuous coefficients. In fact, if we analyze what Grothendieck talks about, there are two types of bridges he talks about between the discrete and the continuous. So the first type consists in relations or equivalences between the discrete and the continuous. And then the first embryo of that consists for Grothendieck in the Weil conjecture. So the Weil conjecture predicts that there should be a tight relationship between arithmetic and topology. And in fact, it is the reason why the Weil conjectures were so interesting for Grothendieck. Whether this is because of this, that it inspired him. And he wanted to understand more, to uncover what was behind the Weil conjectures. The Weil conjectures, for him, appeared as consequences of a structural relationship between arithmetic and topology, and he wanted to understand this relationship. And this relationship was a bridge. So, of course, it inspired him many new theories and developments. So first, as everybody knows, the construction of cohomology invariance, which interplay topology and arithmetic, so analytic cohomology, crystalline cohomology. The trace formulas for this invariance, which are consequences of the properties of the six operation formalism. And also, he mentioned the yoga of weights, which later was at least partially proved, established by Deligne. Then there is the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, I already mentioned, which is an equivalence between a category of, in fact, a derived category of differential nature, systems of linear PDEs, and another derived category of discrete nature. So constructible shear complexes with discrete coefficients. And then there is also the Abelian geometry program. I will say, I will also say something on that. In fact, in this conference, there will be lectures devoted to that subject. So the Abelian geometry program is, for Grothendieck, based on the key fact that objects of purely arithmetic nature, the Galois group of Q, naturally acts on objects of purely topological nature. So I will explain more a little later. And then the second type of bridges consists in objects or theories that can specialize or localize both in the direction of the discrete and the direction of the continuous. So first, of course, there is scheme theory. Scheme theory over spec Z. When you have a scheme over spec Z, you can specialize to discrete geometry over finite fields, but you can also specialize to continuous geometry over R or C, just by base change. So for us, it has become completely obvious, but in fact, it was really a revolution in geometry, just to be able to do this. Then, of course, there is a theory of size. So a small category or essentially small category together with a Grothendieck topology. So this is a general definition which can be specialized both in the direction of continuous topological spaces. A topological space in the ordinary sense is a particular case of site, but it also specializes in the direction of discrete small categories when you just have a category without topology. And here you specialize in the direction of the discrete. And so the sheer fact to have a general definition of the notion of site, which can specialize both in the direction of the continuous and the direction of the discrete, means that you may also have definitions of intermediate nature, such as etal sites, crystalline sites, and so on. And lastly, of course, last but not least, there is a conjectural theory of motives. And Grothendieck insists on the fact that this theory of motives should specialize both in the direction of cohomology theories with discrete coefficients, such as singular cohomology or LHD cohomology, but also in the direction of Hodge cohomology, which is subject to continuous variations. So this means that motives should have both continuous and discrete aspects. Okay. By now I want to come back to the first type of synthesis which appears in Grothendieck's new geometry and which comments in Récolte et Sommeil. So this is the world of toposes. So here he writes that the name topos was chosen to suggest that it is in French, l'objet par excellence, so it is difficult to translate in English, maybe ultimate object, to which the topological intuition applies. So I continue the quote. By the rich cloud of mental images that this name elicits, it should be considered as being the equivalent of the term space, with a greater emphasis on the topological specificity of the notion. So for him, it is completely clear that the toposes are the real object of topology. Topology, he chose that name because topology, in fact, for him, is the science of toposes. So why does he say that it is the object par excellence, ultimate object? First, so he explains that. First, the fact that the notion of topos is more general than any previous notion of space. But at the same time, it is not too general. All familiar, most essential geometric intuitions and constructions can be more or less easily transposed to the new notion of topos. When you have an arbitrary topos, you can talk about the points of this topos. You can talk about the subobjects, just as you are used to talk about subspaces of a space. You can talk about open subtoposes, closed subtoposes. You can talk about intersections, about unions. So all the usual geometric operations make sense in the context of an arbitrary topos. So this means that the notion of topos is not too general. But at the same time, this notion is general enough to encompass a host of situations which, until then, were not considered to give rise to intuitions of a topological or geometric nature. So this means the notion is not too general, but it is general enough to encompass many more situations than all situations previously studied under the name geometry. So this qualification Grothendieck uses, par excellence, ultimate, is not only a feeling. It is justified by the double definition of toposes. First, the constructive definition. A topos is a category that can be presented as the category of sheaves, of set theoretic sheaves on some site. So this is a constructive definition, categories which can be constructed in this way, or presented in this way. And here, we have to remark that this type of presentation is, for Grothendieck, a geometric presentation. But on the other hand, there is also the theorem of Giraud, the axiomatic characterization of toposes as categories which share with the category of sets, the same list of constructive categorical properties. And so Grothendieck writes explicitly that the precise list of properties which are enough to ensure that you have a topos, so the precise statement in the Giraud theorem is not important. What is important is the fact that you have such a theorem, that you may characterize toposes in terms of their properties. So this means that for toposes, you have a double definition, a constructive definition and an axiomatic definition. And so one criterion for protonic, for a definition to be good, is when you have multiple different definitions for the same type of objects. So here, it is a perfect situation. So what does it mean that tuposes have just the same properties as the category of sets? So here, Botanic uses the word pastiche, so pastiches. So the topos is, they share the same list of strongly typed properties as the categories of sets. So here I have listed some consequences of that. When you consider a mathematical theory, any theory, you can talk about models of this theory in an arbitrary topos, just as the model of this category in the category of in sets, the set we are used to study models of theories in sets, but we can consider as well models in an arbitrary topos. When the theory you consider is first order, these models make up a category, which we can denote in this way, T mod of E. Here E is the topos. And if this theory is not only first order, but so-called geometric, which means if it uses constructions only in terms of colimits and finite limits, then any morphism of topos, which by definition is a couple of adjoint functors, the Pellback functor and the Schwarz functor, with the extra property that the Pellback functor is exact. Here I just gave the definition of morphism of topos. So then, just because of this definition of morphism of topos, the Pellback functor induces a functor from the models of the theory in the base topos to the models of the same theory in the topos E over the base topos. And it can be remarked that if furthermore the theory T is algebraic, or more generally Cartesian, then there is also the push-forward functor also induces a functor between category of models. And this push-forward functor is right adjoint to the Pellback functor. And this is especially important when you are considering linear structures. So linear structure is a kind of algebraic theory. So this means that I just say the noise. And so this means the following. If you consider a topos together with an inner ring, oh, what is an inner ring? If your topos is presented as a topos of sheaves on a site, then an inner ring is just a sheaf of rings on that site. And then there is an associated Abelian category, the category of modules, of inner modules over this inner ring. And geometrically, it is just the category of sheaves of modules with coefficients in the sheaf of rings you have chosen. And so here, already, Gotendick had already seen in while writing his Kaoku paper that these categories verify all the Tohoku properties which are needed to develop cohomology. In fact, this is even because of this that Gotendick was led to the notion of topos. Okay, and then if you have a morphism of ring topos, so this means a morphism of topos completed with a morphism of inner rings, either at the level of E or at the level of the base topos S. It is the same because of adjointness. So in that case, there is an associated pair of adjoint linear functors. So the Pellback functors from modules on the base to modules on the large source topos, and the push-forward functor from modules on E to modules on the base topos S. And these two pairs of functors have associated derived functors between derived categories. Okay, and this, so just for this general result, Topazes are, for good indeed, the natural context for cohomology. Then there is the fact that topazes are also the natural context for duality. So here I want to explain a little more about that. But Grothendieck explains that in Récolte et Semaille. So consider an object of a topos, an object G of a topos. Then you can consider the functor, which is a multiplication of object by G. And in whatever your topos is, this functor of multiplication always has a right adjoint. So right adjoint is a so-called exponential or inner Homer. In fact, usually, Grothendieck doesn't use the word exponential, he uses the word inner Homer. Okay, so when you have a couple of sheaves, you can associate to them the sheaf of morphism from the first sheaf to the second sheaf. And in this way, you define an object and then a functor, which is right adjoint to the product functor. And then, just because of adjunctness properties, if you consider arbitrary objects G and D in your topos, there is a natural transformation from G to the inner Homme of the inner Homme of G to D, comma D. Okay, so you go from an object to the Homme of the Homme. Okay, so this exists just for because of general categorical nonsense. But by now you can do the same with linear structures. You can suppose you have a commutative inner ring in your topos, O, and then you have an associated functor of tensor product with an arbitrary O module N. And this functor of tensor product is left adjoint to another functor, which is also some kind of inner Homme. But this time it is an Homme over the base ring, the structure ring O. Okay, so this is a inner linear Homme. Okay, and once again, just for because of the general categorical nonsense, you have a natural transform for any objects N and D from N to the Homme of the Homme of NDD. So if you consider the operation going from N to Homme of N into D as some kind of dualization, so this means there is a natural transformation from any object to the dual of its dual. Okay? And here, of course, we have to make a remark, which is the fact that this natural transformation is an isomorphism in the case when E is the topos set, the case topos, the punctual topos, the most simple topos, if O is a field and if D has dimension one over this field. So in that case, we know that for any vector space with finite dimension, of course, it is naturally isomorphic to the dual of its dual. So it is a basic fact, but Grothendieck will try to generalize this basic fact at the level of topazes, because, as he says, a topos is a pastiche of the category of cells. So when you have a phenomenon which you already know at the level of cells, you may wonder how it can be generalized for more general topazes. And this will lead him to the called the biduality. So I just here present it in just a few lines because Grothendieck, in fact, he mentions biduality many times in Récolte et Semaille. It is extremely important for him. So consider a commutative ring topos, as we said. So we have these two pair of adjoint functors, the tensor product of the inner linear Homme, and the associated derived functors at the level of derived categories. And so this means that by now, if we have two objects N and D in the derived categories of modules over our commutative inner ring, then there is a natural transformation under some mild hypothesis from N to the dual of the dual of N. Okay, but here you see it is the same as before, except that here we are working with derived categories. And so the biduality phenomenon for Grothendieck is when there exists some D, that when we can choose some object D in the derived category of modules on E, such that this natural transformation is an isomorphism for general enough objects N in the derived category of modules over O. And for him, it works or should work for all natural geometric contexts. And another, here, an extra, extremely important remark is that it cannot work without derived categories. So when we were in the world of set, we had a statement which was true for ordinary vector spaces of finite dimension over a field, okay, and we don't need it more elaborate linear algebra. But when we consider a more general topos, here, as Grothendieck discovered, we need derived categories. Okay, and this gives an illustration of a phenomenon which Grothendieck is extremely important, and he also insists a lot on that. It is the use of topos as a powerful tool for discovery. So in French, a puissant outil de découverte. So here I just quote him. The two consecutive seminars, SGF4 and SGF5, which for me are like a single seminar, developed from nothing, both a powerful instrument of synthesis and discovery, that the language of topos represent, and the perfectly developed and perfectly efficient tool that is ethyl cohomology, better understood in its essential formal properties from them on, than even the cohomological theory of ordinary spaces. So these lines will become more clear later. But we can already state what are Grothendieck's topos-oriented principles. It is the following. You start from a notion of fact we already know in the context of some classical geometric theory, such as, for instance, continuous topological spaces, or even only over a point, which means in the topos set. We remember that set is just the topos of sheaves on a point. So suppose you start with a phenomenon you already know. For instance, you start from the basic fact that a finite dimensional vector space is the dual of its dual. So it is a very basic elementary fact. And then you look for a new formulation that makes sense for arbitrary topos or for arbitrary morphism of topos, possibly with extra structures, such as inner rings, if you need a linear. So you look for a new formulation that makes sense for arbitrary topos, and which could be true for very different families of topos and their morphism, stemming out from diverse natural domains of mathematics. And what can be discovered by respecting this principle? What may happen is that the classical starting notion of fact can in this way be transported and transformed into completely new and possibly much deeper notion of facts in a multitude of different contexts. So for instance, the metamorphosis of the phenomenon of biduality of finite dimensional vector spaces into biduality for complexes of linear sheaves. And here, Grothendieck started from something completely elementary, and he has transformed that into something which is very deep, because if you just think about it, you may list the what is needed to phrase this biduality in the world of topos. First, it requires to work at the level of derived categories. So you need to invent the notion of derived categories. It leads to the notion of dualizing complex. And the dualizing complex is a general geometric object which generalizes the one-dimensional vector space in the case of sets. And the dualizing complex is something very subtle. For instance, it is something which takes into account the dimension of the spaces you consider and the possible singularities. So it is something extremely subtle. It also leads to the notion of constructible objects in these derived categories of modules. And here, the notion of constructible complex appears as a good generalization of the notion of finite-dimensional vector space. So this means that, once again, a completely elementary notion has been transformed into something which, for Grothendieck, is extremely important, extremely deep, and which is a key ingredient of his understanding of duality. When you have all these ingredients, so you need to prove a list of properties, including biduality, the fact that you have isomorphism between an object and the dual of its wall in this refined sense. And usually, it is a deep theorem. And the last important point is that this phenomenon, as we have already said, is ubiquitous in geometry, which means, as Grothendieck realized. So this means that you can establish some type of biduality, always framed with the same notions. You can establish them. Grothendieck thinks in all classical context of geometry, in all possible geometric theories you may develop. In everything of geometric nature which you can develop naturally, you have some kind of biduality, and Grothendieck is absolutely convinced that it is always phrased in the same way, which is it is phrased in terms which always makes sense in the context of topologies. So I think we will stop here for the first part of the lecture. So we will resume for the second part of the lecture, for the second lecture in 20 or 25 minutes.
So shall we have a 15-minute break from?
Yeah,
now?
We have a break. Of, I suggest
okay.
15 minutes. Okay, so here it is.
Yeah, so we'll resume at 25 minutes.
Okay, so we resume at 25. Okay.
Thank you very much. Unmuted your computer. Okay, so let's start the second part, the second talk of Laurent Lafourcq.
Okay, so thank you. Do you hear me? It's okay. You see me, you hear me. Okay, so this is the second part of my lecture, which will be a little more technical than the first part. I will continue for a few pages with topologies because Grothendieck talks a lot about topologies. And I already said, his expression that topologies are not too general, but they are general enough. And there is another aspect of that which Grothendieck mentions, and in fact, he comments on this. This is the fact that topologies are a broad enough notion to classify, he says, any type of mathematical structure. So here I give a quote. Other notable examples of topologies that are not ordinary spaces and for which there seems to be no satisfactory substitute in terms of accepted notions are classifying topologies for just about any kind of mathematical structure, at least those expressed in terms of finite limits and arbitrary colimits. Okay. So by now, I want to explain a little what Grothendieck may mean by this statement, which of course is very striking and very important. Okay. So first, trying to understand this statement, we may think about the notion of classifying topologies for first order geometric theories, which in fact, this was developed in the later years. In fact, it's the 1970s by categorizations such as Loewyr, André Joyal, Mackay, Reyes, there is a whole series of people, building on first examples, which appear, in fact, in the PhD thesis of Monica Kim under Potendi. So what is it? You consider a first-order theory, which is geometric. So it just means that the semantic interpretation of this theory in terms of models with coefficients in topologies only makes use of arbitrary colimits on finite limits. Okay. And then here is the theorem, which was proved in full generality, stated and proved in full generality for the first time in the book of Mackay and Reyes. So you consider the following functor. You associate to an arbitrary topos the category of models of the theory in this topos. And you associate to any morphism of toposes the associated pullback functor between the categories of models from the base topos to the source topos. And so the functor, the theorem is that this functor is always representable by a topos called the classifying topos of the theory, which is, of course, characterized by this property and the unique up to equivalence. So it is characterized by the property that for any topos E, the category of topos morphism from E to the classifying topos is naturally equivalent to the category of models of the theory T in coefficients with E. So this is a theorem which is extremely general. And you see that it corresponds already to what Grothendieck had written. He says that there are always classifying topologies for just about any kind of mathematical factor. So you see, it's completely general. At least those expressed in terms of finite limits and arbitrary colimits. So this is already an explanation for this statement by Grothendieck. But there is more to be said, because in fact, elsewhere in Récolte et Semail, it becomes clear that Grothendieck talks about classifying topologies for higher order structures, not only first order structures. And so here is a statement, another quote of Grothendieck in Récolte et Semail. When we consider some type of variety structure, which may be topological, differential, real or complex analytic, Nash, and so on, or even smooth schematic on a given basis, we find in each case a particularly attractive topos. So in French, it says a topos particulièrement alléchant, which deserves the name of universal variety of the species considered. Its homotopic invariance, and in particular its cohomology, which deserves the name of classifying cohomology, for the species of variety under consideration, should have been studied and known for a long time. So he writes that in the mid-80s, in 83 or 84. So this means we are almost 40 years later, and 40 years later, it has still not been done. And in fact, these classifying topologies for all these type of structures he mentions have not been studied at all. Okay, so I want to make more explicit what Grothendieck means. So here I will be a little more technical. So first we need, in order to make precise what Grothendieck means, we first need a category of parametrizing varieties. So we start with a category which may consist of topological varieties, for instance, CW complexes, for instance, or simplicial spaces, things like that, or the category of differential varieties, or the category of real analytic varieties, or the category of complex analytic varieties, or the category of Nash varieties, or the category of schemes which are finitely presented over some base, which may be Z, or a finite field, or Q, or C, or whatever you choose. Then, in this category, you have a topology, a Grothendieck topology. So it may be the ordinary topology for multiple spaces or differential varieties, differential manifolds, or it may be the Ethal topology, or it may be the smooth topology, or it may be the faithfully flat quasi-compact topology. There are many possible choices. And you suppose that this topology is subcanonical. So this means that the composite functor L from the category to the associated topos is a fully faithful embedding. So here I mean the functor L, which is a composite of the Yoneda embedding and the sheafification functor from the category of pre-sheaves on C, which I have denoted C hat, to the category of sheaves, of J sheaves on C, which I have denoted C hat J. And I denoted S because S will be in our picture, it will be the base topos. Okay, so you suppose this is a fully faithful embedding. It is equivalent to requiring that for any object of the category C, the associated pre-sheaf is a sheaf. Okay, so the two properties are equivalent. It is a basic fact of topos theory. Okay, so this is the first ingredient. And then the second ingredient is a natural fibered category of relative geometric structures indexed by the object of C. So what does it mean? It means that to any object of C, let's call it S, we associate a groupoid, which we denote M of S. So a groupoid is a category whose all morphisms are isomorphism. So it is just a collection of objects and isomorphism between them. And objects of this groupoid may or may not have automorphism. Okay. It is a groupoid of relative geometric structures over S. I will immediately give examples. And so to any, you see that for to any object S of the base category C, there should be an associated groupoid. And for any morphism in the category C, from some object S prime to S, so this should be understood as a base change morphism, there should be an associated functor in the reverse direction from the groupoid associated to S to the groupoid associated to S prime. So this is a general situation which, in fact, you can find everywhere when you do geometry. So for instance, so here I give examples. So to any S, you associate, for instance, M of S, which is a groupoid of morphism of the category C, P from some object X to S, with some properties to you require. So for instance, you may require this morphism from X to S to be proper, which means relatively compact in some sense, and smooth, which means without singularities. You may require the fibers of this morphism to have a fixed discrete invariance. So for instance, you may classify cures over S, suppose S is a scheme, and you want to classify, you consider relative cures over S, and you fix the genus of these cures. So this is an example. And this object X over S may possibly carry some extra structure. For instance, you may require them to be relative abelian varieties, or you may require them to be endowed with a relative normal crossing divisor, or to be endowed with an embedding in a fixed projective space, or to be endowed with a so-called polarization. I don't explain what is a polarization. It is a very important notion. So there are many things you may consider, many possible properties. The only property you need in order for what you say to make sense is this property to be stable by base change. And when it is stable by base change, there is an induced functor from any object S prime to S. There is an associated fiber functor as soon as you suppose that your morphisms are squareable. Okay, so I am saying here that this situation is extremely general in geometry, whatever your geometric context. Okay, so here I give a most important particular case. You consider the category of finitely presentable schemes over Z. So this is the base category. And you associate to that the groupoid of relative smooth projective cures, X over S, which are geometrically connected. The fibers have to be geometrically connected. And you want them to be of genus G, with N marked points on the cures. And here, this fiber category you are defining is denoted NGN of S. Okay, so this example is extremely important, but immediately give other examples. You consider a group bundle G over some proper, which means compact object C of your category, compact in some sense. And you associate to any base, to any parameterizing object S of the category C, the groupoid of G, G torsors over the product S cross C. So this means you are trying to classify G torsors on the curve on the compact object C. So for instance, if C is a curve, but it may be more general. You can also consider the following. You consider a proper object in your category, for instance, a proper scheme over a base scheme. And to any S, you associate the groupoid of local systems of rank R over S cross C. So this makes sense, for instance, if you are working with complex analytic varieties or real analytic varieties, even topological spaces. But if you are in the context of algebraic geometry, over, for instance, in characteristic P or in characteristic zero, you can consider the groupoid of L-adic sheaves of rank R, of smooth L-adic sheaves of rank R, over the product S cross C. So this means you are trying to classify smooth L-adic sheaves of rank R over the object C you have chosen. Okay, so these are just examples. But, you could write thousands, yeah, you could really write thousands of examples of naturally defined fiber categories. So then what may happen? So these groupoids indexed by the parametrizing object S may be sets or real groupoids with automorphism. If they are sets, M is a presheaf of the category C. This presheaf may be a sheaf or not. If it is a sheaf, it may be representable by an object of C called, in that case, the moduli variety of M or not. But anyway, if M is a presheaf, it may be sheafified. You may associate to this sheaf an associated to this presheaf M an associated sheaf, because the sheafification functor is defined in general. And then this sheafification, M tilde, is an object of the topos, of it is an object of the topos S associated to the category C endowed with the topology J. And as it is an object of this topos, you can consider the relative category S over M tilde, whose objects are morphism to M tilde. And it is a general fact in topos theory that when you start with a topos, you choose an object, then the associated relative category is also a topos. So in this way, whatever the properties of M, we have associated to M a topos, which we write EM. And this topos, as any topos, has cohomology invariance, it has homotopy invariance under very mild, it always has cohomology invariance, and it has homotopy invariance under very mild hypothesis. And in the case M is representable by an object of C, SM, this topos and its invariance are the same as those of this object. But here, the important remark is that these invariants are defined whatever the properties of M. If M is representable, they are the invariants of the geometric object which represents the functor. But if M is not representable, even if M is not a sheaf, Anyway, there is an associated topos, and this topos has invariance, and Grothendieck would want to study this invariance. But here I have considered the case where each M of S is a set, but in general it is not. So let's suppose M is just a fibered category. Most often, in geometric context, but not always, this fibered category over the C is in fact a stack for a topology J. So this means that the isomorphism in the groupoids M of S may be defined locally by gluing for the topology J. And it also defines that the objects in this category F of S may be constructed J locally through so-called descent data. So I don't make precise what it means. All these notions were introduced by Grothendieck once again. So this is a very natural, in some sense, stacks are the equivalent for groupoids of the definition of sheaves for sets. So a stack is, in some sense, just a sheaf of categories, an appropriate geometrically defined notion of sheaf of categories. But even if M is not a stack, which happens, it has an associated stack because there is a stackification functor for fibered categories, just as there is a sheafification functor for pre-sheaves. And by now, so this means we can always transform M into a stack. And if M is a stack, it may or may not be what Grothendieck calls a multiplicity in French, which is a stack locally isomorphic for the G topology to object of C. So in the context of algebraic geometry, this is what people have called the Lidman-Ford stack. But Grothendieck calls that a multiplicity. I think it is a word he already used in the 1960s before the paper by Deligne and Manford was written. So anyway, M and its stackification, M tilde, define a relative topos. So this is also an extremely important construction, which in fact is explained in the thesis of some paper Giraud. You consider an arbitrary fibered category on the associated stack, there is an associated relative topos, EM, over the base topos S associated to the site CJ. And this topos, this relative topos, as any topos, has homotopy and cohomology invariants. So they are always defined, whatever the classification problem you consider. So here I'll give a most important example, which is the example studied by Deligne and Manford in their famous paper, building on Riemann, Teichmuller, and also Grothendieck. I mentioned that Grothendieck had given a series of talks about the Teichmuller tower at the Carton seminar. So you consider NGN, the classifying fibered category for pures of genus G with N chosen points. And in fact, this is a so-called multiplicity, but people have called that later the Lidman-Ford stack. You even know its dimension, which is 3J minus 3 plus N as a geometric object. I think this was already known to Riemann. Okay, so it is a multiplicity under technical hypothesis. You just have to avoid trivial cases, so you have written conditions to be verified. And this multiplicity even has very natural modular compactification, MGN bar, which is also defined as a solution of a broader classification problem. So it is this compactification is also associated to the problem of classification of some structures. And the boundary strata of the compactification are constructed from the M, G prime, N prime of lesser dimensions. So I don't give the precise details, which are a lot of time would be difficult to explain. But the important fact is this part. Okay. And so by now, there is an implicit question in, so it is not explicitly stated by Grothendieck, but I think it is implicit in what he writes. Consider as before a natural geometric fibered category. So to any S in the base category, category of varieties, you associate the groupoid of parameterized of a certain type of geometric structures parameterized by S. And then you have this associated fiber category M and its associated classifying topos. We have just said that by general topos theoretic constructions, to any such M, we can associate the classifying topos EM, which is engulfed with a canonical projection morphism to the base topos S associated to the site CJ. And then the question, the implicit question I understand is the following. How to interpret the morphism of toposes from an arbitrary topos E to EM over S? And in other words, what is the model of a second order theory in a relative topos E over a base topos S? And then what we need is to develop a theory of classifying relative toposes for some notion, still to be made precise, of geometric second order theories. And possibly after that, we would have to generalize to higher order theories. So here I have to mention that the general theory of relative toposes, so a topos over another topos, has been developed in the last years by Olivia Caramello together with partly together with her student Ricardo Zanfa. They will talk about it. And so, and in fact, Olivia is presently developing theory of classifying topos for some type of second order theories. So I hopefully it will be an answer to this question, which I think is implicit in the use by Grothendieck of the word classifying topos for this type of second order situation. Okay, so by now I have finished with topos, but this is an especially important theme for Grothendieck. In fact, he would have wanted the whole mathematical community to work with topos. He is very bitter on the fact that topos were more or less neglected for. So he was writing in the 80s, and he was very, very unhappy with that. But then I want to explain more on the ubiquity of the six operation formalism for duality, both with continuous and discrete coefficients. I want to talk about that because for Grothendieck it is extremely important. So he says that it was discovered by him between 1956 and 1963. And first, it was discovered in the case of complexes of OX modules with coherent cohomology over notarial schemes. So this means that for him, it was the first work on the subject of duality. What he wanted to do is to understand or generalize serduality for coherent modules. So serduality is for a variety over a field. And of course, Grothendieck wanted to generalize that for arbitrary morphism from, for instance, a smooth projective variety to a smooth projective variety. And he wanted to transform the absolute statement of Serre into a relative statement. And then he he developed in that way formalism of duality, of relative duality, for morphism in the category of projective schemes. And then later, a few years later, he established the same type of formalism for discrete coefficients in the context of etal cohomology of schemes. And then it was an understanding, a generalizing of Poincaré duality in a technically much more difficult situation than ordinary cohomology. And so Grothendieck says these two extreme cases were sufficient to form the conviction of the ubiquity of this formalism in all geometric situations giving rise to a Poincaré type duality. And so he convinced himself that this, he says, catch-all formalism, formalism attraptu, so this catch-all formalism of the six operations works or should work for the most important types of spaces that have been introduced so far in geometry. And then he gives a list. Algebraic size spaces, such as schemes, scheme multiplicities, which we already mentioned, and so on. Analytic spaces, both complex analytic and rigid analytic, and similar. Topological spaces, in the ordinary sense, but also waiting for the context of time spaces, espace modéré, which he would want to be defined. And surely many others. And he mentions the category cat of small categories serving as homotopy type. And even, in fact, in his mathematic writings of the 1980s, Grothendieck, in fact, has explicitly studied that question, the question of the six formalism operations in the context of the category cat of small categories. In particular, he has defined a notion of proper functor and smooth functor between categories. And he mentions, so I am always talking about Récolte SMI, so he mentions that he had fully checked some cases as exercises. So as, for instance, the case of piecewise linear spaces. And this was not published at that time. It does not appear in the HGA volume. And to my knowledge, it was never published by anybody, even now. But he just mentioned he has done that as an exercise, that it was not difficult. And he mentions, as I already said, that he had given SGA 5 talk about the general features of the six operation formalism and the many geometric situations where he already knew that it applies. But as I said, the published SGFI volume does not contain any trace of this talk. Okay, so I want to say a little more about the context of the six operation formalism. So consider a geometric category C. So it can be very general. It can be topological spaces, differential varieties, analytic varieties, schemes over some base, and so on. Endowed with a functor to the two categories of toposes endowed with a structure commutative inner ring. So to any x, you associate an associated topos, ex, together with an inner ring, ox. And here, it may be this inner ring may be continuous or discrete. So what does it mean? Continuous coefficients, it means that ox is a structure sheaf consisting of algebraic, analytic, differential functions on X that is part of the definition of X as a geometric object. So for instance, an algebraic variety or a scheme is a topological space together with a sheaf, the so-called structure sheaf of functions, of algebraic functions, which of course have to verify the fact that it is locally isomorphic to the spectrum of some commutative ring, okay? But it had already been introduced by Cartan and Serre, the notion of analytic manifold, which is a topological space endowed with a structure sheaf, which will be locally isomorphic to the sheaf of holomorphic functions on open subsets of C to some power, and so on. So here, you see, continuous means you are considering the structure sheaf of the type of geometric structure you are considering. Discrete coefficients, it means that OX is the so-called constant sheaf consisting of locally constant functions with values in some fixed ring. So this fixed ring, lambda, maybe Z, or Z divided by some N, or R, or C, you see, but the important point is that it is fixed. It is no more varying. And anyway, In both types of cases, either with a structure shift of continuous functions or a discrete shift of locally constant functions, there are always associated linear categories. So first, for any object X, the Abelian category of OX models on the topos EX. Okay, so this is an Abelian category, verifying all the Kaoku properties needed for the cohomology. And then there is the associated derived category of this Abelian category, DX. Okay? And then we are already given four operations. For any object X of the geometric category C, there is an inner tensor product on the inner Ohm functor in this Abelian category of modules, and these functors have associated derived functors in the derived categories. And for any morphism F in the category C, there is an associated morphism of ring topologies from EX to ES. And so there are associated functors between the associated linear categories. And so the push forward, the pullback functor and the push forward functor, which are adjoint one to the other. And this pair of adjoint functors have associated derived functors. And these associated derived functors are adjoint one to the other under some hypotheses, which in fact are always verified in concrete. Okay, and then Grothendieck has introduced two extra operations, which for him are what we need to realize a general enough notion of relative duality. So for him, in all situations which are geometrically significant, we should be able to associate to any morphism F of the category C a pair of adjoint functors between the derived categories. So here it is very important that this pair of adjoint functors should be defined not at the level of the category of modules, but at the level of the associated derived categories. So this pair of adjoint functors, which are denoted in this way, such that the first one is a covariant functor. The second one is a contravariant functor. It reverses the direction of the arrows. And they are adjoint. But you see that unlike the pair F upper star, F lower star, here the covariant functor should be right adjoint to the contravariant functor. So this means you see the adjointness relation is in the reverse direction. The left part is the covariant part, the left adjoint part is the left adjoint component is the covariant part, the right adjoint component is the contravariant part. This is the opposite as the pair F upper star, F lower star. Then another property is that the covariant part should identify with the ordinary push-forward functor when F is relatively compact, proper, in a sense to be defined in the context of C. And another special case is that the contravariant part should identify with the ordinary pullback when F is an open embedding, or more generally, an ethyl morphism. And here, it has to be remarked that this notion of open morphism, or more generally, ethyl morphism, in fact, makes sense at the level of topologies. So when you have a morphism of topologies, it makes sense for this morphism to be open or to be ethyl. Okay. So this property should be verified. And the most important property is the duality diagram we should have for any morphism X over S in the category C. And any object MS of the derived category associated to S, to the base object, the associated commutative square, the associated square we have here. So here you see there are two vertical arrows. The first one is this operation which is on the left, which is called cohomology with compact support. And on the right, we have ordinary push forward. And then we have the two horizontal arrows, which consist with the dualizing functor at the level of derived categories defined by MS on the base and by is push forward by this strange functor F exclamation dot applied to MS. And so here we have a square of four functors. And the property to be verified is that this square should be commutative up to canonical isomorphism. So this square should mean that ordinary cohomology is dual to cohomology with compact support. Okay, so this is, and this, the commutativity up to canonical isomorphism is really the dualizing property. It contains as particular cases Poincaré duality in the case of discrete coefficients and Serre duality in the context of continuous coefficients, and it should be completely general in all geometric contexts you may think about. Okay, and as you see, of course, it is not an absolute statement. It is a statement for morphism. It is a relative statement, so it is a statement which obeys the relativity principle, which Grothendieck introduced in mathematics, and which for him is extremely important. I think Olivia in her lecture will talk about that. Okay. And then the last part of this six operation formalism is that there should be a notion of constructible objects in the derived category dx for any object x of C, such that first, the structure sheaf we have chosen is constructible. Secondly, the constructible object should be stable under all six operations. Okay, so this means it should contain the basic objects and it should be stable under the six operations. Another property is that any object X in our geometric category C should have an associated so-called dualizing complex in the derived category, such as the biduality natural morphism should be an isomorphism for any constructible object MX in our derived category. So I already said that, but you see this notion, this is why I said that this notion of constructible object should be the appropriate generalization of the notion of finite dimensional space where when we are in the context of sets. And lastly, these dualizing complexes should be on the different objects should be related one to the other by the fact that for any morphism F in our category C, the dualizing complex of X should be just the exceptional pullback image of the dualizing complex of S. So, in the vocabulary of Grothendieck, it should make up a crystal with respect to this morphism relating the different derived categories. Okay, so here we have to make some important remarks. So first, the fact that the construction of this functor, so F, the covariant part, should be of subtle global nature because it should really see whether your morphism F are compact, relatively compact, which means proper in some sense. So this means that in our geometric concept, context, there should be a notion of proper morphism. Secondly, the construction of its right adjoint, so which is contravariant, should be of very subtle local nature. Because in the classical geometric settings, this conjunction is relative to the property of smoothness or the fact we have singularities. And it should, it is also related to the notion of dimension, of relative dimension of X over S. So this means that when you are able to construct this functor, it means you have implicitly a notion of dimension in your geometric context. And another important remark is that the six operation formalism, once it is established, is powerful enough to generate Lefschetz type trace formulas. And so in the Eladic or crystalline case, to solve the first three Weyl conjectures. So the last Weyl conjecture, which is pretty, is of course even deeper and of a different nature. So it is related to the so-called yoga of weights, which I just mentioned. Okay, and here there is a general question raised by Grothendieck. So I just copy what he has written once again in Récolte Sommeil. So he writes, there is a lack of basic reflection of the following type to describe, if possible, in the context of arbitrary toposis and discrete coefficients as a first step, after there would be the even more intricate, even more subtle situation with continuous coefficients. So there should be notions of properness, smoothness, local properness, separation for morphism of toposis, allowing to derive a notion of admissible morphism of toposis, for which these two extra operations, F exclamation dot down up, have a meaning and are adjoint one to the other, so as to obtain the usual properties of the six operation formalism. So here, what Grothendieck would want is a general property of a general study of duality at the level of toposis. And not only in many different contexts. So what he would want is a general theory so that all the theories where we already know the six operations should be obtained as particular cases of the general theory. And this, of course, has not been done. Okay, so I want to mention, just to finish this part, I want to mention a question, in fact, a very deep question raised by a formula, a famous formula of Grinfeld. So I just want to remind it. Excuse me. Yeah. So consider first a finite field and then a smooth projective curve over this finite field, which you suppose is geometrically connected. And consider the category C of finitely presented schemes over this finite field. Then we can associate to any object S of C the groupoid of Eladic sheaves of rank 2 on S cross C, which are absolutely reducible. So I mean that their fibers over the geometric points of S are absolutely irreducible. Okay? And so this is a fibered category. And there is an associated stackification of that for the Étal topology on C. And then Drinfeld has computed, using in fact Langlands correspondence for GL2, for function, the function field of Q of C, which has been proved by him, and which is, of course, an extremely deep result. So Drinfeld has checked that when you compute the number of points of this stack with values in the finite extensions of FQ, you find a formula. And this formula has the same form as if M tilde, so the stackification of M, was a variety over FQ, verifying the Weyl conjectures. So what does it mean? It means, or it may mean, or it may imply, that this stack M tilde has some kind of six operation formalism, that the six operation formalism maybe or hopefully should apply to M tilde. But M tilde is not a scheme and it is not even an algebraic stack. So we are very far away from algebraic geometry. And so this question, this computation by Drinfeld is in fact a very good motivation for studying the general question raised by Grothendieck about the fixed operation formalism at the level of toposis. Okay, so this is not here. Of course, it is not in Récolte Sommeil, but it is just, in fact, a very important paper by Drinfeld. In fact, the paper by Drinfeld is just one page. Drinfeld is usually very dense, and so this computation means that this question, this general question by Grothendieck in Récolte Sommeil, is related to very deep questions. Okay. So I just want to mention the bridge between continuous and discrete coefficients, which is provided by some form of non-commutative biduality. So here, this is a so-called Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. Grothendieck calls that with, in an ironical way, Theorem du Bon Dieu. I don't want to explain why. And it was established in the late 1970s, so I think independently, by Melkut and Kashiwara. So the context is a context of an analytic variety, X. So we consider OX, the structure sheaf of meromorphic functions, X. And you consider DX, the sheaf of linear differential operators. So this is a sheaf of non-commutative rings generated over OX. OX is a structure sheaf, it is commutative, but you add derivations. And so you consider the sheaf of linear differential operators. And then the center of this non-commutative sheaf is just the sheaf of locally constant functions of your analytic variety. And so the correspondence expresses some equivalence at the level of derived categories between some complexes of dx modules, so modules over this sheaf of non-commutative rings, and so this is continuous, and complexes of modules with over the sheaf Cx, which is a sheaf of locally constant functions with values in C, so this is discrete coefficients. And why? And I say, and in fact, not I, Grothendieck says that it is some kind of biduality. So why? Because what we can do is the following: we start from the derived category of modules over Px, over the sheaf of differential operators, of linear differential operators, and we go to the derived category of modules over the sheaf of locally constant functions. And we have two functors in the two reverse directions. And these functors are defined by duality. So first, we realize that OX is a module over DX. Differential operators, of course, act on functions, on analytic functions. And so it has a meaning when we have a module over M to consider the sheaf of modules of module morphism over dx from M to OX. But of course, this sheaf is because dx is not commutative. This sheaf is not a sheaf of modules over dx. It is just a sheaf of modules over the center of dx, which is Cx. So here we go from continuous coefficients, from discrete coefficients. And in the other direction, when we have a module over Cx, we can associate to it the sheaf of Cx morphism from L to Ox. And in this way, we get a sheaf of modules over Dx, because Ox has a structure of module over Dx. Okay, so we have two well-defined functors, and these two well-defined functors have associated derived functors. And here, the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, it has these two derived functors induce two reverse equivalences between two full subcategories of our derived categories. So on the right, we have the full subcategory of complexes which are constructible. So here we once again we have the notion of constructible complex. And on the left, we have a subcategory of complexes of D-modules, which are so-called holonomic with regular singularities. So these are notions from differential geometry. Okay, and so this theorem is considered as by Grothendieck as a bridge. And you see that this bridge is established as some kind of biduality. But here it is biduality with a ring of coefficients which is non-commutative. So the fact that it is non-commutative is really what allows you to go from the discrete to the continuous or from the continuous to the discrete. Okay, so I remarked that there is also, and in fact, Grothendieck remarked in my conference that there is also a version of that when you consider no more an analytic variety or an algebraic variety. So this also was established by Kut. Okay, so this is all I wanted to say about the theme of biduality. And lastly, I want to say a few words about Grothendieck dreams of an abelian algebraic geometry. And so it will be just an introduction to the lectures on that subject that will be given later in this school. Okay. So, So here I begin with a quotation, with a quote by Grothendieck. And he writes that this dream of an abelian algebraic geometry was nothing other than a continuation, an ultimate continuation of Galois' theory, undoubtedly in the spirit of Galois. So I want to precise what is this dream. Here, the basic fact is that this dream is to express part of arithmetic and arithmetic geometry in terms of ordinary continuous topology. More, in particular, to present the Galois group of Q in purely topological terms. Or to express in purely topological terms the problem of determining rational points of arithmetic varieties or of determining morphism between arithmetic varieties. So you see, this is really an extremely deep bridge which Grothendieck conjectures between arithmetic, which is a word of the discrete, and ordinary topology. So you just want to explain how the basic principle under which allow the sheer definition of this possible bridge. And all of this is based on Grothendieck reinterpretation of Galois' theory and his fusion of Galois' theory and the theory of Poincaré fundamental groups into a unique theory. So here is the context. You consider a geometric object, X, which may be a topological space in the usual sense, or a scheme, including the spectrum of a field, or even a general topos E. You just suppose that it is locally connected and connected. So for a scheme, it is automatic. For a topos, it is a very mild hypothesis. Then you consider a point of X. So it may be, if X is a topological space, an ordinary topological space, it is just a point of this space. If a capital X is a scheme, it is just a geometric point of this scheme, which means a morphism from the spectrum of an algebraically closed field K bar to X. And if X is a topos, if E is a topos, here we just consider a point of the topos. Then we consider the category of covers of X, which means in the classical setting, locally constant covers, in the scheme setting, locally constant etal covers of our scheme X, and in the context of a topos E, it is just a subcategory of locally constant objects of the topos. So it always makes sense. And then, the associated fundamental group is just the automorphism group of the associated fiber function. through the Pellmark functor, which is associated to our point X, there is an inuse functor from the category of covers, which is a subcategory of the associated topos, or of the topos we consider, to the category of sets. And this functor has a group of automorphism. And this group, so it is just a group, and in fact, it is endowed with an induced co-discrete topology. And then there is the Grothendieck-Galois equivalence, which says that this functor induces an equivalence between the category of from the category of covers to the category of sets endowed with a continuous action of this topological group. Okay, so this is Grothendieck's general theory of so-called what he called Galois categories, which is a unified theory containing as particular cases both Galois theory and the theory of the Poincaré fundamental group. So here there is a corollary of this theorem, which everybody, in fact, just I say that for the student, just check it as an exercise, that the group of self-equivalences for this category of coverings identifies with the so-called group of outer automorphism of the pi one group. So outer automorphism means the group of automorphism of the group divided out by the invariant subgroup of conjugation automorphism. Okay, so I already said that in the classical cases, if X is an ordinary topological space, the pi one group defined in this way is just the Poincaré fundamental group consisting of homotopy classes of loops at the point X. And if X is just the spectrum of a field, and the geometric point we consider is just an algebraic closure on K bar of K, then the pi one group, the automorphism group of the fiber functor, identifies with the automorphism group of K bar over K, which is just the Galois. Okay, so once we know this, we have a bridge from algebraic geometry to topology. Consider an algebraic variety over C, and let's consider the associated analytic set of points with values in C with ordinary associated topology. And let's consider an element of this set, small x. Then there is another theorem. When we have a cover of X as an algebraic variety, of course, there is an induced cover of X of C as an ordinary topological space. And here, the theorem, which was proved in SGA1, and which generalizes the so-called Riemann existence theorem, is the fact that this functor induces an equivalence from finite total covers of X of the scheme to finite covers of X of C as an ordinary topological space. And this has a corollary. It means that the algebraic fundamental group of X is just the profinite completion as the topological fundamental group, the Poincaré fundamental group of X of C. And here, you see this theorem is, so in some sense it was already known to Riemann, is a proof in SGA1 just takes a few pages. It is quite easy. But for Grothendieck, it is a marvelous thing. It is a door to a new most fundamental theme because it relates algebraic covers to topological covers. It is an equivalence between the world, between something very deep defined in algebraic geometry and something defined in pure ordinary topology terms. And it is especially for Grothendieck, it is extremely important because on the topological side, for him, this is what we can understand readily. Whereas on the algebraic side, it is something very deep, very difficult, we would want to understand a little more. Okay, so by now we can apply that to arithmetic. Let's consider a number field. So a finite extension of Q containing Q bars, algebraic of closure of Q inside C. Let's consider an algebraic variety over E and the associated induced variety over Q bar with its points in C, which we can consider as an ordinary topological space. And then we have that the Galois group of E, the absolute Galois group of E, which is the automorphism group of Q bar over E, naturally acts on the category of finite ethal covers of X bar. Okay? So this is see if we have a finite ethal cover and we compose it with an automorphism of X bar, we get another finite ethal cover. But here, the important point is that the category of finite ethal cover of X bar identifies with the category of finite topological covers of X of C. And so this means that the Galois group acts non-trivially on something which is defined purely in terms of ordinary topology. And we can also remark that if we have an arbitrary morphism of algebraic varieties over E, from a scheme of variety X to a variety S, then it induces an exact functor between the category of finite ethal covers, which identifies with the category of finite topological covers of the associated ordinary topological spaces. And this functor will be exact, and it will respect the actions of the Galois group. Okay, and so there are natural naive questions which appear there, which maybe are too naive, but at least we can ask this question, waiting for more elaborate stuff, which will be explained in the later talks. So when we go from morphism from X to Y, defined over E, that we have associated exact functors between the category of finite covers of the associated topological spaces. And these functors have to respect the action of the Galois group. So question, are there situations when this map is injective, when it is surjective, when it is one-to-one? Okay, so this is a basic naive question of an Abelian geometry. And then there are the question will come in for the Galois group of Q, which of course is the most central object of number theory. So we already know that the Galois group naturally acts on the category of finite topological covers of any variety defined over Q. So do we know the variety defined over Q, and which of course are interesting from the geometric viewpoint? The answer is yes, we have already mentioned that. We have the multiplicities MGN and their compactifications classifying curves of genus G with N marked points. These are very, very natural objects of algebraic geometry. In fact, they are algebraic multiplicities defined over Q. And they are related by a whole network of natural morphism that relate all of them, and which Grothendieck calls Teichmuller tower. So this means that the Galois group of Q acts on the categories of finite topological covers of all these varieties, the MGN and their compactifications. And all these actions has to respect the natural functors between these categories, which are induced by all maps which make up the Teichmuller tower. And here, there is another very important fact, which is a consequence of the theorem of Bélier, which Grothendieck had conjectured. This is the fact that already in the most simple, non-trivial modular variety, so N04, here you are just classifying a projective line with four points. And this is easily shown to be isomorphic to the I1, the projective line, minus 3 points defined over Q, 0, 1, infinity. Here, as a consequence of Bélier's theorem, we get the action of the Galois group of Q on the category of finite topological powers of this very simple geometric object is already faithful. So this means that the Galois group of Q is embedded into the group of outer automorphism of the profinite completion of the pi 1 of the affine line of C minus 0 on infinity. Okay, so then we consider this embedding and we may ask what is the image? And does it provide a way to describe the Galois group of Q in concrete, purely topological terms? So this is the beginning of Grothendieck dream of an abelian geometry, which has been studied a little, but maybe not enough so far by some mathematicians. But at least what you can see is that the starting point of this dream is very simple. It is a basic fact. It is a sheer consequence of the definitions, especially the fact that Grothendieck was able to unify the Galois theory, which is of discrete nature, and the theory of the Poincaré fundamental group, which is of continuous nature. And because of this unification, which in fact is so general that it exists at the general level of topologies, because of this unification, you have a natural action of the Galois group of Q on this very simple topological objects, in particular, covers of C minus 2 points, finite covers, finite topological covers of C minus 2 points, which may be described in by a very simple type of drawings, which Grothendieck calls descend enfant children's drawings. Okay, so I will stop there. Thank you very much for your attention.